So my name is Soya Jung, and I'll be moderating this event this evening. It's my great pleasure to do that. Thank you so much for coming. We're starting a little bit late, but we're going to try to make up time as we go. So this is a conversation. In 2 hours, we're going to cover feminism and war in the Asia Pacific. I'm not sure whose idea that was, but I'd like to thank the Wing Luke Museum for having us, for hosting us this evening, especially Vivian Chan for handling all of the logistics, and thank you to all of our organizational partners, the National Asian Pacific American Women's Forum, Seattle Chapter, LILO, the Pacific Rim Solidarity Network, Gabriella Seattle, the Asian Pacific American Labor Alliance Seattle Chapter, the World Affairs Council, and the Channel Foundation, which generously provided the snacks and drinks critical to any successful events. So my unenviable job right now is to help draw a picture, a kind of conceptual and emotional container that's spacious enough to hold all of the perspectives, all the heartfelt humanity, the stories that we'll hear and feel from our speakers tonight, knowing that as powerful as they are, they represent but a sliver of the stories of war and conflict, of militarism, of brutal domination that exists in this world today. I know that all of us must have Syria on our minds tonight, given the horrifying chemical weapons attack on Tuesday. There's no way to make sense of the image of a father saying goodbye to his infant twins at a mass grave. The death toll in Syria has now reached 470,000. From the droughts and famines in Africa to political assassinations in Latin America, war touches every continent, every people on the globe. When Christine and I started planning this event a few months ago, we wanted to place the urgent question of war on the Korean Peninsula in a larger global context of militarism, of US imperialism, and of the blustery, kind of cock-waving, nationalistic brand of misogyny that we have witnessed in Trump's rise to power. We wanted to think with all of you about what the opposite of these things would be, so that together we can imagine turning the tide of authoritarianism, violence, and extreme inequality in the world toward peace, mutual care, and genuine democracy. We chose feminism as a framework, not just because women have been on the front lines of peace movements around the globe, not just because women's bodies have been controlled and violated in service to war, racial capitalism, and colonization, but also because the world is in crisis. It is screaming out for a different kind of politics, for our collective survival, a different common sense. So tonight we want to think with you not about the flimsy neoliberal I'm with her brand of feminism that says we just need to elect more female bodies to office or to break the glass ceiling in corporate America, but a deeper feminism that rejects supremacy, domination, and the deadly rivalries of capitalism and empire. A feminism that instead builds interdependence, compassion, and a reverence for the earth. There's nothing flimsy about this feminism. It is anti-racist, it is anti-colonial, it is anti-war, and it is not new. In a speech published in 1984, black feminist, lesbian, author, and activist Barbara Smith said, "We are in a huge mishmash created by mad people at the top, and we are constantly trying to rectify the situation. I see the process of rectification as what black feminism is all about, making a place on this globe that is fit for human life." 2 days ago was the 50th anniversary of Dr. Martin Luther King's 1967 Beyond Vietnam speech at Riverside Church, in which he publicly opposed the Vietnam War. For years, I've listened to this speech every MLK Day. Dr. King knowingly risked alienating significant portions of his base, including powerful white liberals like President Johnson, by denouncing not just domestic racism, but also militarism and capitalism. King warned that these giant triplets formed a blueprint for quote-unquote violent co-annihilation. He called for a spiritual revolution of values fueled by a deep and all-embracing love. That he was killed exactly 1 year later has always haunted me. It is as if silencing his radicalism, his anti-racist commitment to human solidarity, was necessary to declare the freedom dreams of black Americans achieved. to erase all arguments for dismantling the color line by denying its existence, by creating new stories about the deserving versus the undeserving of humanity. The year of Dr. King's Beyond Vietnam speech, there were 159 race riots in the United States, driven by the same forces that drive black uprisings today: poverty, police violence, political neglect. Just 1 year earlier, in 1966, the New York Times published William Peterson's success story, Japanese American Style, and the US News and World Report published success story of one minority group in US, praising Chinese Americans in Chinatowns. Chinese and Japanese Americans who previously had been seen as disease-ridden, untrustworthy, sexually deviant, and criminal were magically redeemed as exemplary non-whites. After World War II, US elites needed to tweak America's racial folklore to win the Cold War contest for global power. The Soviet Union criticized the United States for its racism, so the United States created the Asian American model minority to prove the possibility of racial uplift while maintaining the validity of rules that justified the punishment of rebellious blacks and other threats to the liberal capitalist state. But how do we make sense of this? How do we make sense of the fact that this is also the same time as the fight to preserve the International Hotel in San Francisco's Manila Town, when the owner, Milton Meyer Company, threatened to demolish the building and evict low-income elderly Asian residents? How do we make sense of the fact that this was the same time as the My Lai Massacre, when US soldiers of Charlie Company of the 11th Infantry Brigade arrive at the village of My Lai, meeting no resistance from the 700 inhabitants, yet killing over 500 Vietnamese civilians, including 119 children 7 years old and younger, and 27 elderly in their 70s and 80s. When black lives don't matter, life matters less. And Asian lives only matter when they justify black death. When colonization breaks indigenous relationships to the earth, all of our survival is at risk. Making phrases like water is life is necessary. We are raised in relationship to one another, and our survival depends on understanding this. For Asian Americans, our entry into this nation, our arrival has been as rivals. The biggest roadblock to multiracial solidarity is seeing race as a set of natural categories of people rather than as a system of state-brokered relationships in a global scheme of deadly competition. The state violence of immigration enforcement makes national borders real, and our rivalries within capitalism give meaning to racial boundaries. In the words of scholar and abolitionist Ruth Wilson Gilmore, put simply, capitalism requires inequality and racism enshrines it. Not everyone can belong in a capitalist economy, so race is the folklore to explain the excluded. What has been the outcome? Well, the war that Dr. King risked his work and his life to denounce 50 years ago led to a refugee crisis. Southeast Asian refugees displaced from the killing fields of Cambodia to refugee camps in Thailand, then to re-education camps in the Philippines, were trained to be cheap labor by the time that they arrived in the United States. Many were resettled into urban sites of economic and political abandonment during the 1980s, when the war on drugs was decimating black communities. Refugee children then grew up to face welfare and immigration laws in the 1990s that drove them into economic crisis, incarceration, and now deportation. Our stories, our histories are connected. Over half a millennium ago, Christopher Columbus, financed by Spain, reached the Americas while trying to get to Asia in search of gold. On the island that is now the Dominican Republic and Haiti, he built the first European military base in the Western Hemisphere. He took indigenous Arawak people as prisoners and killed those who refused to trade their bow and arrows. 2 years later, the Treaty of Tordesillas, known as the Doctrine of Discovery, divided the world in half and claimed possession of the entire world west of that line for Spanish conquest and all east of it to Portuguese conquest. Hundreds of years later, enslaved African people in Haiti would end French colonial rule in the largest slave rebellion in the Western Hemisphere. The immense capacity of the US military, built up to fight Indian wars on this continent, would later be turned toward Asia and Latin America. I often narrate my own story by saying that I come from war. The reality is that since the Doctrine of Discovery, we have all come from war. Seeing ourselves as distinct, natural, and inevitable nations and racial groups has led to a kind of drawn-out political and spiritual suicide, because these distinctions rely on violence. When Dr. King was questioned about why he was speaking out against the Vietnam War, he said, quote, "At the heart of their concerns, this query has often loomed large and loud. Why are you speaking about the war, Dr. King? Why are you joining the voices of dissent? Peace and civil rights don't mix, they say. Aren't you hurting the cause of your people, they ask. And when I hear them, though I often understand the source of their concern, I am nevertheless greatly saddened, for such questions mean that the inquirers have not really known me, my commitment, or my calling. Indeed, their questions suggest that they do not know the world in which they live. Tonight, we have an amazing lineup of people to help us understand the world in which we live. We will begin with poet and translator Dawn Mi Che, who will read from her book, Hardly War, and then hear from Christine An, who is co-founder of the Korea Policy Institute, founder of Women Cross the DMZ, and so much more. She's a dear friend and a tireless voice for peace and social justice in Korea and in the Asia-Pacific region. And she will bring us up to speed on the situation on the Korean Peninsula. And then we'll have a panel discussion with a few other speakers that I'll introduce later, just so you don't forget who they are. you can have that fresh in your minds when we start the panel. And so with that, I will turn it over to Dawn Mi.
Thank you, Soya. So I'm reading two poems from Hardly War. And Hardly War will be sold at the end, and all the money will go towards Women Cross DMZ. So it's $18 to $20. I don't have any change, so $20 will be really nice. you can also make a check directly out to Women Cross DMZ. This poem is based on that photograph on your right at the top with a girl with her brother on her back. 무궁화 꽃이 피었습니다. 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 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 무. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 궁. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 화. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 수. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 국. I refuse to translate. 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 Oh, over. Suicide parade. Father Cyanide. Let's take a closer look at the most feared weapon used by the US in the Korean War. A gelling powder composed of naphthalene and palmitate, hence napalm. 65% oleic acid, plus 30% coconut fatty acid, plus 5% naphthenic acid, necessitates, most arguably necessary, clinging, burning, necessitates gasoline and stirring, hence gas stir, which is to say South Korean laborers funnel napalm powder into gasoline tanks. Moisture is the greatest problem in mixing napalm. Reds dead without a mark on them, hence hardly. Wooden warehouses and thatched hut villages common in Korea were made to order for firebombs, as were Japan's wooden cities. Hence napalm, and hence gas stir, and the respectable distance of the plains maintains a gusto of ring spots, maintains Bomben brand shrimp fleischen, which is to say incendiary bomb shrunken bodies. So the story of napalm is still being written in Korea. Hence napalm, plus hence gas stir, double hence, daughter cyanide. Thank you.
Am I taking it from here? Okay.
Maybe I'll just quickly, so thank you for coming. What an amazing room. And I'm deeply moved by Dawn Mee. Her book, Hardly War, has been reviewed by the New York Times Review of Books, by Kirkus Review. I mean, she's a star here in Seattle. And it's, this is our first time meeting, even though we've been huge fans and sisters forever. It's, anyway, thank you, Dawn Mee, for that beautiful poetry reading and supporting Women Across TMZ. Thank you to our partners for organizing such an amazing event. Thank you, Vivian and the Wing Luke Museum for hosting. I want to give special thanks to our partners, Elaine Nonneman and Katrin Wilde of the Channel Foundation, who support trailblazing women peacemakers like Women Across TMZ. And I want to give a special thanks to Soya, who actually I haven't seen in over a decade, and to just place in context where Soya and I met. We traveled together on a delegation to South Korea in 2006 at the height of a struggle of Korean farmers resisting the expansion of Camp Humphreys, which is a US military base. And basically, the US military was going to rip their land. So we had to cross two military checkpoints at nighttime. We got to the village. We were ushered into a barn. Like this room, there were about 100 elderly farmers. And they were holding like the 1,000th candlelight vigil. And basically, they were fighting to keep their fertile farmland, their established orchards, their homes, their community center, their schools, from being completely destroyed, to accommodate new houses for US troops, for Starbucks, for water parks. And so that was the genesis of my relationship with Soya. So we witnessed together the destruction of our motherland in the service of US empire. We're gonna show a little film, but before I showed the film, I just thought maybe I could tell the genesis of a women's peace walk. So you'll learn in the film, in 2015, I helped organize a delegation of 30 women. It included Gloria Steinem, included two Nobel Peace Laureates, women from 15 countries, many that fought and participated in the Korean War. And we crossed the demilitarized zone, which is the most militarized border in the world. We held parallel peace symposiums in Pyongyang and in Seoul. And we marched with 10,000 women on both sides of the DMZ. Before I kind of go into the current context, I just thought maybe I would share the origins of the peace walk. And basically, it started with a dream. And I might just follow to the script, because I know we're really tight on time. So basically, it started with a dream. It was in 2009, and I woke up in the middle of the night, and like many of you who have insomnia, I turn on the computer, and up on the home screen of the New York Times was an article about the flooding of a river called the Imjin River. And this river flows through the heart of the Korean Peninsula, and it was flooding. And at that time, the hotline between North and South Korea was cut off. No talking, no military-to-military communication. And North Korea allegedly lifted the floodgates, which sent water gushing down and killing six people, including a young boy and his father, who were fishing in the early morning. And I remember reading this and thinking, what? Why can't they just pick up the phone? And at that time, it was Lee Myung-bak, the former CEO of Hyundai. Why couldn't they just like, you know, and Kim Jong-il, the father of Kim Jong-un, why couldn't they just pick up the phone and say, hey, we need to lift the floodgates, otherwise our farms will flood. And we are in a persistent food crisis, and it's gonna destroy our farms, it's gonna destroy our harvest and kill many lives. But they just couldn't do that. And I just remember just being angry about that. So I went back to sleep, and that's when I had this dream, literally. I was wading in the river, and it was about chest high, and it was right before the break of dawn, and I was with others. And I was in the South, and that's because I was born in Seoul. And we were wondering, are they going to come? Are they going to come? And literally right before the dawn broke, the sun rose over the horizon, there was this glow of light, and it was people, and they were coming down the river. And there was this extraordinary sense of love. And I don't know if you've seen images of elderly North and South Koreans, people in their 70s, 80s, who have not seen their siblings since they were 5, 6, 7, and being reunited for a day. I mean, it's the most heart-wrenching thing to witness. And I was witnessing that, and I was so moved. But I wanted to find the source of the light. And it could be that I am in the diaspora, but I wanted to just keep going up the river. So I did. I kept wading up the river. And that's when I came to the most incredible scene, which was a circle of women. And they were stirring some thick liquid in a big black kettle. And whatever they were stirring, they then poured into vessels that then became the light that flowed down the river. And I woke up at that moment, and my poor husband, I knocked him really hard. I said, Albie, I know who will end the Korean War. Women. Women will end the Korean War. And of course, he looked at me, he was like, oh my God, can you go back to sleep? And that was in 2009, I really wrestled with that question, and I thought, well, I need to know. I need to know, how have North and South Korean women communicated across the most militarized border in the world? They must have. So I got a fellowship at the University of Michigan, and I did the research. And what did I find? This is extraordinary. So for anybody who is Korean in the room, you must know who colonized Korea. Who colonized Korea in the last century? Japan. It was a Japanese woman that brought the first meeting of North and South Korean women. She was a member of the Japanese Diet, and she heard the call of Korean women that said, we need to stop the Korean War. We need to deal with the conflict because it's enabling the militarization and arms race of Northeast Asia. That was in 1991. Look where we are today. But that was the first meeting of North and South Korean women. And when I realized that, I realized in times of impasse, there is a role for people outside the Korean Peninsula to intervene. And so that's when I set out. And so in 2013, the idea came to me when a little known story in Reuters about 5 New Zealanders who rode their motorbikes across the DMZ, I was like, what? If they can do it, women can do it. And so that's when I set out to do it. And the first person I contacted actually was Gloria Steinem, because we had worked together against the struggle of a naval base on Jeju Island. And she wrote me right back, and she said, if we could do this, calling for peace and the reunification of Korea, would you do it? And she wrote me right back, and she said, I lost several classmates in the Korean War, and if I could do my small part to help with the healing and division of Korea, I will. And that's about it. I mean, basically, I printed out this, there's a great photo and quote from Gloria Steinem. It says, dreaming is a form of planning. And I printed that out, I stuck that on my computer, and I set off to do it. So with that, I think I'll quickly show, it's a 10-minute trailer of a documentary that's in progress by Deanne Borchet-Lim. She accompanied us on the trip. She's a fabulous filmmaker. I'm sure she might have been here already. But anyway, enjoy, and then I'll give some remarks afterwards.
Just a few things before I go into the talk of the evening about the anniversary of Dr. King's speech. I just wanted to show you the scarf that we wore and a little bit about it. So this, hopefully I'll do it right. Yes, so it's a W. And when we thought about crossing the DMZ, we said we should wear white for peace and obviously the tragedy of war. But we wanted to wear something that also symbolized hope and the future. And so in Korea, when a child turns 1, they wear hanboks or chosunboks in the north, and the top is jogori. And so it's a very colorful fabric, and they wear it to symbolize health
prosperity in the future. So this is the scarf that we all wore as we crossed the DMZ. So that's what's so beautiful about women's peace building, you know? Mix it up a little bit. Here it is. Okay. So will you give me a flag when I'm at 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so can I put this over here or no? Okay, I'm just gonna hold it. So we're gathered here to mark the 50th anniversary of Dr. King's prescient and revolutionary Riverside Church speech, in which he said, that's okay, Vivian, I'll do it. This business of burning human beings with napalm, of filling our nation's homes with orphans and widows, of injecting poisonous drugs of hate into the veins of peoples normally humane, of sending men home from dark and bloody battlefields, physically handicapped and psychologically deranged, cannot be reconciled with wisdom, justice, and love. A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death. End quote. Dr. King made the link between what US foreign policy does abroad and the havoc it wreaks at home. In Dr. King's prescient speech, he said, quote, a time comes when silence is betrayal, end quote. Well, that time has come in relation to Korea, where the Trump administration is considering a first strike against North Korea. In fact, on this very day, in this very moment, Donald Trump is meeting with Chinese President Xi. On the top of their agenda is North Korea. Last month, the Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi warned that the US and North Korea are like two accelerating trains coming toward each other. To avert war, China proposed that North Korea suspend its nuclear program in exchange for halting the US-South Korea military exercises, and that a dual track be put into place that would deal with denuclearization and concerns of basically establishing a peace mechanism. Not only did Trump reject that proposal, he has threatened China that unless it deals with North Korea, we will. And quote, it won't be good for anyone. This is from a reality TV star who has threatened to, quote, bomb the shit out of our enemies. The Trump administration says all options are on the table. And as Rex Tillerson said on his trip to Asia a few weeks ago, that includes a military option. While the US corporate media widely covers North Korea's seemingly never-ending missile and nuclear tests, it fails to disclose why they are acting so belligerently. Tens of thousands of US, South Korean, and now Japanese soldiers are currently rehearsing a first strike and invasion of North Korea. That includes deploying B-2 bombers and a team of Navy SEALs that took out Osama bin Laden. Yes, North Korea is testing their long-range missiles to improve their capacity to strike the US. That would include Seattle with a nuclear warhead. But they're actually not crazy. In fact, imagine if you were sitting in Pyongyang. Wouldn't you have learned a few lessons from Iraq, who didn't have weapons of mass destruction, or Libya, who did? Let's not forget the Lancet report that found that the US occupation of Iraq has resulted in more than 500,000 dead, largely poor and defenseless people. But North Koreans don't need to look back at the Middle East. They just need to look at their own history of surviving indiscriminate US bombing during the Korean War that destroyed 80% of North Korean cities and claimed the lives of 1 in 4 North Koreans. As you saw in the film, 4 million people died in the Korean Peninsula in the Korean War, mostly innocent civilians. On one of my trips to Pyongyang, our guide would take us around the city and they would often point to this building and they'd say, oh yeah, that's the building. And it was kind of this rickety old traditional Korean building, and I thought, what is the fascination with that building? It's a restaurant. And it turns out that was the only surviving building from the Korean War. That's how devastating it was. You know, like journalists that traveled from Hungary or from the UK, they said it was like walking on the moon. The only thing that stood were chimneys. That was the only thing that survived. So more bombs were dropped on Korea from 1950 to 53 than all of Asia and the Asia Pacific Islands during World War II. In 1 year into the Korean War, US Major General Emmett O'Donnell testified before the Senate, quote, "I would say that almost the entire Korean Peninsula is just a terrible mess. Everything is destroyed. There is nothing standing worthy of the name. There are no more targets in Korea." Not only did President Truman contemplate dropping an atomic bomb, the US maintained nuclear weapons in South Korea up until George Bush Sr. We need to have this context when we understand the North Korean regime's belligerence. Instead, in the US, the Korean War is known as the Forgotten War. Silence is betrayal, and it's time for some truth-telling. I don't mean to make tonight a history lesson, but when the Pew Research Center, this just came out today, that 2 out of 3 Americans would support the use of a military strike against North Korea, I think it's critical to understand this history. In 1945, the United States, along with the Soviets, divided the Korean Peninsula. Does anybody know how that happened? 2 young officers in the State Department. So the US were victors, right, in World War II, after we defeated Japan, along with the Soviets. And so 2 young officers basically took the National Geographic, they tore a page that had the Korean Peninsula map, and they drew a line across the 38th parallel. That's how Korea got divided. Isn't that crazy? And they wrote a memo to Stalin. They said, you take the north and Pyongyang, and we'll take the south and Seoul. And that began the process of 2 military governments, Soviet-controlled and U.S.-controlled. And what is kind of mind-blowing to me is that my parents lived, actually, under Japanese occupation. They've since passed away. But for 35 years, like, Koreans were basically enslaved. My parents had to take Japanese names. They couldn't speak Korean. I mean, you know, it was bad. And so you can imagine there was this thirst for the Korean people to have independence, have a more just and equal society after living through that repression. And so there was actually the most inspiring people's committee, grassroots movements. I mean, kind of like we got a taste of it with Bernie Sanders, right, in this country. But that was happening on the Korean Peninsula. They were preparing for their liberation and their independence. And what did we get? We got a US and Soviet military occupation. And what did the US do once they took the South? They basically put into power Koreans that had collaborated with the Japanese. And what did they do? They quashed the most vibrant movement for democracy and social justice. And that is the legacy that we're living with today. I mean, President Park Geun-hye from South Korea, she was the daughter of the dictator that ruled South Korea with an iron fist. The war is living on. So, how am I doing on time? 5 more minutes? Okay. So it's no? 2 more minutes. Oh, shit. Okay. All right. So I'm 3 more minutes? Well, it's fitting to be discussing Korea, right, in the context of Dr. King's speech. Because, in fact, it was Korea that has justified the expansion of the US military in the Asia Pacific. And it's what has inaugurated the military-industrial complex and the massive military spending that has built the greatest war-making force the world has ever known. Today, the US boasts an infrastructure of global surveillance, flying killer robots, floating aircraft carriers, a network of more than 800 bases in 70 countries, and last month, President Trump, I don't even want to use the word president, but he proposed $54 billion on top of the already $596 billion we spend annually for war. Is that insane? That's more than the next 7 countries combined. Russia, China, France, UK, South Korea, Japan. People, our nation is dying, and we have to do something about this. So I'm just going to end with 3 things that give me hope in this moment. 1 is the inspiring organizing of women, especially in South Korea. Not only this peace walk, they have basically been doing it on an annual basis. There was one last year, they're doing one again this year. but they are on the front lines of challenging a US missile defense system, the THAAD Lockheed Martin missile defense system that is being deployed right now in South Korea. And they're on the front lines. It's melon farmers, housewives, people with no organizing experience, and they're standing up and saying, we don't want to be caught in the standoff between the US and China, and it's going to impede our process for peace and reunification with Korea. That is inspiring. The comfort women issue, the South Korean women, they have been challenging Japan and saying, we want a formal apology. And that has basically really strained relations between Japan and South Korea. Women are on the front lines, ordinary grassroots women. They are changing the geopolitics. And they're saying, we don't want a bilateral relationship based on the agenda and interests of corporations or of the military. We want it on genuine security, on women's rights, on human rights, on people's right to food, land, clean air. That is inspiring. The second thing is the likelihood of a liberal president in South Korea. So on May 9th, it's going to be a snap election because the people of South Korea took to the streets. And for weeks, I don't even know if you know this, but they like waged candlelight vigils every week starting in October, and it led to her impeachment. With those candlelight vigils, they sought to bring light to a time of darkness in South Korea. They brought transparency to a time of corruption. It is inspiring. And they brought down a corrupt dictator, basically, in South Korea. And justice prevailed. Democracy prevailed. The people prevailed. And I think that we have to be hugely grateful. And the leading contender is Moon Jae-in. And he's not just some young, fresh politician. This is a seasoned politician. He was the chief of staff under Noh Moo-hyun, who was the last liberal president. And he said, the first thing I'm going to do is visit Pyongyang versus Washington, D.C., because engagement in diplomacy is the greatest guarantee of security for South Korea. And the last thing, and I'll end here, so he's giving me kind of the stink eye here, is the rebirth of democracy here, right? On the second day of Donald Trump's presidency, 1.3 million women gathered in Washington, D.C. for the country's largest protest ever and inspired protests in sister cities all around the world. Now, it was amazing, but the platform, to give you my little critique, did not include anything about anti-war or anti-militarism. So what it did include in its unity principles was a commitment to ending police brutality and racial profiling and targeting communities of color. While not considered an anti-war or anti-militarism movement, the Black Lives Matter platform declares, quote, America is an empire that uses war to expand territory and power, end quote, and calls for halving the military budget and closing all foreign military bases. And among the Dreamers and movement for undocumented immigrants, there is recognition that the same companies that are building detention centers are the ones building our bases. As Sophia Campos of United We Dream put it, quote, if one wanted to organize folks in the US that understand the destructive impact of American militarization, immigrants would be a good place to start. And that is what is happening. On April 4th, a coalition of more than 50 organizations committed to the cross-movement multiracial justice fight launched Beyond the Moment, uniting movements from April 4th to May Day. I think it's beyondthemovement.org. Grassroots Global Justice is one of the organizing groups. We must resist the Trump budget that will give more money to defense contractors like Raytheon, Lockheed Martin, and Boeing, who it's right here, right? It's based here in Seattle. I mean, this is so crazy. The CEO in 2015 earned $29 million and didn't pay a dime in taxes, okay? So as the saying goes, we got money for war, but we can't feed the poor. And if there was ever a moment to unite our struggles, it is now. And if there was ever an opportunity to talk honestly about the history of this nation as a settler nation built on genocide, slavery, and migrant labor, it is now. If there was ever a time to connect our struggles for democracy, justice, and liberation with resistance struggles in the Asia Pacific, such as South Korea, in the Philippines, in Guam, Japan, and Okinawa, it is now. Our time is now to build a just and secure world that is based on safe land, water, food, shelter, healthcare, and education for our communities. Let's seize it before it's too late. Thank you.
Sorry, it went so over.
I don't know about you. I could sit here and listen to Christine talk for another hour. Unfortunately, we don't have that kind of time. So I would just invite all of us to think about this evening as an opening, an opening into thinking about these issues together, our connections together in the context of war and militarism. So at this point, I'd like to bring up our panelists. So these are all people who I consider actually dear friends of mine, as well as colleagues, sort of comrades in the movement. So Matt Rumley, organizer with the No Dapl campaign and a writer with Last Real Indians, a major force behind the recent Seattle City Council resolutions to divest from Wells Fargo and to oppose the Keystone XL pipeline. Matt, I could go on and on about Matt. I think I've known Matt for about 20 years. So Matt, thank you for being here. To his right is Jill Mangaliman. Jill Mangaliman, who is the executive director of a local grassroots environmental justice organization, Got Green, amazing organization, and a member of Gabriela Seattle, who she's there representing today, working to advance the struggle of women in the overall movement for national liberation and genuine democracy in the Philippines. And then to Matt's left, appropriately, is Cindy Domingo, longtime labor and human rights activist who played a key role in the Asian American and Filipino youth movements of the 1970s in fighting the Marcos dictatorship in the Philippines, in advancing women's rights internationally. I could go on and on and on. Cindy is a longtime sort of force in the progressive movement in the Seattle area. And then here to my two to my right is Chandan Reddy, associate professor in the English department at the University of Washington, author of Freedom with Violence, Race, Sexuality, and the U.S. State, and his scholarship focuses on the relationship between gender, sexuality, migration, and empire. So let's give a hand for all these brilliant people. And since we only have one mic, I'm just gonna like walk around and hand it to people who are going to speak next, if that's okay. And then I think that Katrin had offered to be a timekeeper. So if you could just signal, I think we'll take maybe 9 minutes per speaker. So signal maybe when they're at a 1 minute mark, that would be great. And folks, if you can, don't avoid Katrin's eyes. you have to look at Katrin. So I wanted to start with Matt. As I kind of hinted at in my opening remarks, the military power of the United States was really developed in order to fight Indian wars within the United States to steal Indian lands. And so I wanted to start with Matt and ask you, do you see Standing Rock and No Dapl, those campaigns as a feminist movement? And what is the relationship between defending Mother Earth and war and militarism? And I'll just walk over to you.
I'm a doc yippie. Chante waste na pechu zepelo. Wakia wanata na machiapelo. Ya waslaha amatahayelo. Ate wayaki Charles Rimley. Ina wayaki Donna Harrison. Tokashila wakantaka. Duwamish makoche ki awopila, duwamish oyate ki owichakiayo, ya woslaha okiayo, na mini sose, mini wichoni ki tokashila owichakiayo. Well, good evening. My English name is Matt Rimley. My Lakota name is Wakia Wa'anatan. And I first and foremost would like to give thanks and acknowledgement to the Duwamish people, for whom's land all of us are a guest on. In fact, one of the first laws that the forerunner to the Seattle City Council passed when it was created was an ordinance to ban all Native peoples from Seattle city limits. After that law was passed, that was followed by vigilantes going around and burning down every single Duwamish longhouse that housed many Duwamish families all throughout this area. So even as a Native person, I'm Lakota from Standing Rock, we always give acknowledgement to the First Peoples of the lands that we are our guest on. My parents are Charles Remley and Donna Harrison, and I'd like to thank Soya for the invitation to come share some words tonight. So I have been active on the fight against the Dakota Access Pipeline and a number of other issues relating to protecting our tribal homelands back in or what we call the Ocheti Shakowi, the Seven Council Fires of the Lakota Nation. To answer your question, what folks are seeing or have observed in the fight against this pipeline is really more the expression of who we are as Lakota people. So, for example, with my own involvement, it started in about December 2015, when an aunt who's living back in Standing Rock gave me a phone call expressing her concern about this pipeline because it was the tribe was getting no consultation as they were required to via treaty rights and federal law and international law. And they were holding no community hearings on the reservations. So she said, "Nephew, you know, I'm really concerned. A lot of people don't even know about this pipeline and Standing Rock and Cheyenne River, Pine Ridge and stuff. So can you help out?" And this is what I mean. In our Lakota culture, when our women tell us to do something, we do it, period. And that's what Lakota, that's how we are as Lakota people. Even dating back to, you know, I'm wearing a shirt in remembrance of Wounded Knee 2 in 1973, which was the second largest military buildup since the 1890 massacre that took place at Wounded Knee, took place there. And those men came there because the women and the grandmothers specifically asked them to. So they're willing to die because that's what the grandmothers asked. So what you see in Standing Rock is exactly the same thing, is our women asked for people to come and support the protection of grave sites, of sacred sites, of water. And so my involvement started with simply writing about it through Last Real Indians, and then eventually going out there and joining others on the front lines out there. One thing we like to also say is, you know, when you saw them, when the kind of world attention got brought to Standing Rock was around more like August, when the mass arrests started happening and the private security was releasing their dogs and biting people and stuff. What isn't known is why them bulldozers were out that day. In our historic preservation officer detailed all the sites where all the areas within where that pipeline was going to go through in Cannonball. He had gone through and documented where all the grave sites, all the sacred sites, and sites of cultural and historical significance were. He gave that to the federal judge, who passed that on to Energy Transfer Partners. And 2 days later, that's the exact same area that they bulldozed. So anybody, I don't care who you are, where you're from, you know, if you're wherever your grandparents, parents, great-grandparents are laid to rest, your loved ones, if you saw a bulldozer bulldozing over their bones, you would be pretty upset. You'd be pretty angry. Sacred sites, that's just a different name for where we go to pray, where we go to give ceremony. So we don't pray in four walls and a roof. Where we go is specific places that we're told to go to give ceremony. So that's the exact same thing. When the bulldozer, you know, if anybody in here goes to a church, a temple, a synagogue, a temple, You know, imagine a bulldozer just bulldozing it down right in front of you. And that's exactly what happened, what was happening on that day. So to get back to your question, though, you know, about being women-led, but that's who we are, period, as Native peoples, as Lakota people specifically. And what that is that dates back to our origin story. It talks about the creation, our creation story, and the giving of roles and responsibilities. And the Wiyan, Wichasha, the man, the woman, we're all given different roles and responsibilities that to contribute to, and responsibilities as Lakota people. So with that is we are instructed, we call it original instruction. We're given roles and responsibilities and original instructions to ensure the continuation of all life, not just of our own lives, of our own tribe, our own tribal community, but of all creation. So we are, as Lakota, given very specific places that we are to go conduct ceremony and on a certain time of year to ensure to, that all life continues. That's no different than if you look at these trees out here. You know, right now they're filtering carbons and releasing oxygen. In the ground underneath us, them worms are going through the soils and releasing nutrients for things to grow. Them bees are going around and pollinating. You can literally go through all creation, all of our relatives, whether they're fish, insects, you know, they all are fulfilling their responsibilities, and they don't have to sit and think about it. They don't have to think, should I fulfill my responsibility as a tree today? It just does it naturally. We're the only ones that have strayed from those responsibilities because of colonialism, genocide, because of slavery, indoctrinations, assimilations. We have been taken away from our roles and responsibilities. But as Native peoples, that's why we fight so hard to retain it. You know, we live under settler colonialism. We live under occupation since 1492. War never ended for us. We live it daily. The taking of our lands and the taking of our resources, it's never ended for any tribes across what we call Turtle Island, you know. So that pipeline is no different than in the 1800s when they were going to dig gold up into Montana, and instead of laying down a pipeline, they're laying down railroad tracks to cross through our lines and engage in economic terrorism against us by slaughtering and destroying our traditional economy. So we declared war against them then, because again, we have certain roles and responsibilities to fulfill. So what you see now is no different. You're watching settler colonialism and colonization happen in 2017. And speaking of militarism, you saw the third largest military buildup since the end of the so-called Indian Wars just there in Standing Rock. You had Department of Homeland Security, FBI, the various police departments, the National Guard, all out there. And some people saw it when they came in and raided those camps to push us back into, which was tribal land, but to push us off the area that they wanted to lay the pipeline. You watched, everybody, the world watched colonization, colonialism happen in 2017. And that was live ammunition that they went in with. Those were snipers in those helicopters and up on those hills. So absolutely, we take the direction of our women to get back to what you're saying, but because they're what's most valuable and important to our society, to our people, the women, the children, and our elders. But again, that's fulfilling responsibilities. You know, as men have certain responsibilities to fulfill, and like that aunt that told me she needed help, then we show up and we engage and participate in that. So, thank you.
Thank you, Matt, for sharing so generously with us. And we're going to hear from each speaker and then leave time at the end for questions of everybody and also try to generate some conversation among the panelists as well. Jill, what has been the role of feminism in the fight against imperialism and militarism in the Philippines? And what are some of the major campaigns that Gabriela Seattle is waging right now?
Thank you. And thank you, Matt and Christine and Soya. I also want to thank the native people of this land for which we are on, and to honor our elders who came before us and paved the way for, you know, all of us to continue to fight. Again, we stand on the backs of our ancestors and people who are continuing to fight for their freedom and true liberation and for the earth. I am the Solidarity Officer, Gabriela. I am not going to pretend to be an expert, so I have cheat notes on my hand and also on my phone, which keeps flipping in and out. So if I am look like I'm texting, I'm actually trying to get to my notes. And thank you for that question. Gabriela, one of our main campaigns is to end violence against women. And what we know and have learned from when the bases were reinstated in the 90s, that violence against women has increased by 600%, that where there are military bases, there is violence and an increase of sex industry, which target women, children, and trans people. We know that the Philippines, as a former colony of the U.S., has continued that relationship, this unequal relationship of parent and child country. In fact, I wanted to read a quote from a very long speech from 1900 at the height of the Philippine-American War by, where did it go? Senator Albert Belvedere. I'll just paraphrase, where he was justifying to continue the war to say that the Philippines is ours forever as a gateway to Asia, as a gateway to resources that the US government, even in the 1900s, after buying the land from the Spanish for $20 million, wanted to continue to own the Philippines. And of course the Philippines were fighting back and haven't stopped fighting and to this day are still resisting. Something also that we know in Gabriela is that where there is resistance, there is also backlash and violence as well. Where'd my phone go? Here we go. Sorry about that. I'm nervous. I don't know why I'm nervous. You're all so wonderful people. I'm just going to gaze at you for a second as I find my notes. We've know there's been immense extrajudicial killings, human rights violations from the Philippine Army, which is U.S. backed. The U.S. has been pouring money into the Philippines, even as they were booted out. Their bases were kicked out. They found a way to be there as temporary bases. Without a definite end. And so there is still presence of the US military. There are still US personnel training Philippine Army and paramilitary forces who target protesters or target the landless peasants who are defending their lands against corporations who are after the resources and are mining in the country in mostly in Mindanao. And so there has been many deaths, but also more recently the killing of Jennifer Lade, a trans woman who in the in Olongapo by a corporal military officer, Joseph Pemberton. And it was her mother who was very vocal in calling for justice. And it was people mobilizing from Gabriela and from ally forces to demand that the Philippine government prosecute him. And because of the relationship that the US has with the Philippines, they were able to protect him from, even though he reached a guilty verdict, because of the visiting forces agreement, because of the enhanced cooperation agreement between the US and the Philippines, they were able to prevent him from going to a Philippine prison. And to this day, you know, there are challenges. It's not too different from the Subic rape case in 2005, where Nicole, a woman who was gang raped by US Army officials, escaped justice and was not prosecuted because, again, the US has the power to even thwart the Philippine courts. And so this is another showing of how the US manipulates its influence. And this is called what is called imperialism. They've been able to expand their reach through military force, through funding, through economic policies, to this day, since 1900, continue to control the Philippine government. And something that gives me hope is that the continual organizing that is led by women. I was on Expo, I think it was last time I was there was in 2014, and the women leaders are fierce over there. They're human rights lawyers, they're mothers. They are on the front lines. Whenever there is a mobilization, it's usually the women at the front lines to protect the rest of the people, because they feel like if the women are on the front lines, you know, perhaps the police will be less violent. But the women are fierce, and they will not let anyone let anything. The U.S. government, the Philippine Army, come at their community. There, I've seen heard stories and seen women and aunties, grandmas be defending their communities again from displacement, from military, and it's really empowering to be there, but also to bring those stories back and to remind ourselves as people in the U.S. we have a responsibility on our government to defund the military, to take back those U.S. dollars that are being poured into terrorizing the people in the Philippines, that money should be going towards services, right? Our youth are being indebted with student debt, and why is it that we are spending trillions of dollars on war and this war on terrorism instead of spending dollars here in our own communities while people are hungry and homeless and struggling. And so I think that my phone is frozen now, so I'm gonna, I'm just gonna wing it. it's just because I'm surrounded by greatness too. This is a very powerful panel. I do think that as long as there is, the U.S. presence in the Philippines, the Philippine people cannot start to move towards their own sovereign nation, that as long as the U.S. bases are there, that the people will never really have, ownership of their resources or the land, or begin to build the industry and the jobs that their people so desperately need to keep their people home. There are 6,000 to 7,000 Filipinos leaving the Philippines every day. And it is a Philippine program, the labor export policy, that is sending overseas workers every day because they do not have the will, the political will, or the capacity to build their own jobs in their own country. And so we see Filipinos leaving, majority of whom are women. And so Filipinos are around the world, are treated like commodities, just as how the military treats women and trans people as commodities in the sex industry by the military bases. Like, we are not seen as human in the eyes of imperialism. We're commodities. And so in order for us to change all of that, I think that the first step is to remove U.S. imperialism, to remove the U.S. presence. And again, that movement is going to be and always will be led by the women of the community in the Philippines.
Poor Cindy, we should have thought about the order of the seating here. And way to power through, Jill, with your phone situation. Thank you. Cindy, so you attended the 1995 UN conference on women in Beijing. Some people in this room may have been children at that time, not born yet. Can you share with us the significance of that gathering and also what kinds of political shifts that you've seen since then?
So I use a pen and pencil and paper, just so I'm old school, but that happened to me once, so I don't do that anymore. And I just want to say thank you to Matt. I wish we could send all our men to your nation for re-education and training, because men really should be following women's leads. And that's what's the problem with most of the world, is men are not following women's lead. You know, it's true. Probably most of you were maybe, I was teasing Gina, how old were you when in 1995 when the women's conference happened? She said, oh, I was five. I said, well, I guess you weren't there, were you? Or she could have been. But, you know, every so often in your life, you experience something that changes your life. And that's what the fourth International Women's Conference that the UN put on in 1995 in Beijing. It changed my life, and I think it changed the 50,000 people that were in Beijing at the time, both for the formal conference of the United Nations, but also for the parallel conference in which women's organizations came to build what we're now calling an intersectional movement, and a movement in which women could lead the world and build a platform for gender equality. And that's what happened in Beijing. And that's why it has never, ever happened again. It has been over 20 years. And at the 20-year mark, it was debated whether or not they would have another International Women's Conference. That International Women's Conference was 20 years in the making. It began in 1975 in Mexico City at the first International Women's Conference hosted by the United Nations, followed in 1980 in Copenhagen, 5 years later, and then in 1985 in Nairobi, strategically being hosted in countries in continents around the world so that women's voices could be equally represented in the different continents in which the International Women's Conference was held. And in 1995, organized by a Filipino woman at the center of it, Irene Santiago, the United Nations, led by women, decided to hold the Beijing Conference. And while there were 40,000 to 50,000 predominantly women, some men, there were thousands of other people that were at the borders of China trying to get in who could not get visas to come into that conference. From the Northwest, Sharon Santos and I organized a delegation of 32 women, mainly from Seattle, at the prompting of two older women who were prominent white women in the Women's Peace Movement, Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, Jan Kate, who is still alive and remembers very much in China. She went with us, as well as Carolyn Canifax, who has since passed away. And those two women became our mentors, became the women that said, you got to be there in Beijing. Why wouldn't you want to be there? And I said, well, you know, I got two kids, and yeah, okay, I want to get away. I want to get away from my kids. I'll go. And then she says, well, you have to take these other women with you. And so Sharon Santos, who all of you know is the Bang Up organizer, convinced myself and the other 32 women to go. And it was a racially diverse group of women representing various issues. We worked for a year holding many, many conferences, organizing fundraisers so that we could be a diverse group of women, older, younger, people who would never, women who would never have the opportunity to go to China. And we prepared, we studied. What are the issues that were happening around the world, that were happening in our country, so that we could go as informed women to that conference, so that we could also go with our own agendas of what would it take to build gender equality in our country, but as solidarity activists who are fighting imperialism around the world and as feminists. And it was in the world that we lived in then that we went with a vision of what it would take to build gender equality in particular in our country, but what would it take to build solidarity with the women, the thousands of women that we met there. And it was, I mean, I didn't know what to expect. And it went beyond my expectations. And as I said, it changed my life. It changed my own personal agenda as I engaged with women from 189 countries. I mean, I probably didn't meet a woman from every country, but, you know, through the workshops, through the panels, through the plenaries. The theme was women's rights are human rights. That was the slogan for the Women's March. That reflected how Beijing carried on through the decades to impact women today, because that was the theme for the Women's March. Women's rights are human rights. The United States would not send a formal representative to represent the women of this country. At the time, the president was Bill Clinton, and Hillary Clinton was appointed on his behalf to represent this country. Now, I voted for Hillary. I'm glad I did, because the present person in the position he is in now does not represent mine or probably none of your interests here. But she spoke, and she really understood the slogan, women's rights are human rights. And she spoke to what that would mean for women in this world, what it would mean if all of our rights were seen as human rights. And from that slogan, at the formal conference, in representatives of 189 countries, they came up with what is called now the Beijing Platform for Action. And that action agenda was what women went back to their countries, tried to get their governments to formally endorse that platform for action, which covered 12 critical areas. So it covered women in the environment, women in power and decision making, the girl child, women in the economy, women in poverty, women against violence against women, human rights of women, education and training of women, institutional mechanisms for the advancement of women, women in health, women and the media, women and armed conflict. So you could see it was a very comprehensive platform in which gender equality, in which a program, in which how each country was supposed to design a platform reflective of all these 12 critical areas, so that women could become equal. And all of these areas had to be tackled if women were to become equal, to gain their equality in their countries. One of the first countries that passed the Beijing Platform for Action and came up with an agenda for how women would how the country would address all of these critical issues was Cuba. Of course, because Cuba understands women's rights are human rights. They have one of the most advanced platforms and movements in which women have been able to reach gender equality in their country. Almost, right? But they make every year at the Commission of Status of Women at the United Nations, countries are supposed to come with reports on how they are advancing on these 12 critical areas, how they are advancing in terms of gender equality. And unfortunately, our country is miserably failing, as we can see what's happening in our country. So Beijing has continued to inspire. Did anybody here else go to Beijing? Oh, okay. Oh, I thought Sharon, you had gone. Oh, I would have taken you. But, you know, I think the second part of this is what's changed in the world. One of the reasons why the argument was why not to have a 20th, another Beijing kind of conference, was that things have changed so drastically for women in this world in terms of the rise of right-wing movements, in terms of the turn back of governments on reproductive justice issues, in terms of the status of women in war-torn countries, that there were many women's movements that thought the progressive platform that was put forth in Beijing would be dismantled. You know, on the other side, they never wanted to see 50,000 women again together in one place, that because they were afraid, man, they'd probably have a revolution. But I think I just want to address one other thing. I think in particular in this country, I didn't know that in the women's big march that the issue of war and a peace movement was not addressed in a more whole-sided fashion. But in this country, we don't really have a peace movement anymore. And if you think about it, the peace movement was motivated and built because we brought our boys, mainly our boys and men, home in caskets. Because of the advancement of the technology of war, we don't see that anymore. We have many men and women coming home with different other injuries that are not physical. A lot of the mental, due to brain injuries. Some are, you know, loss of limbs. But it doesn't reflect the type of response in previous wars where there were many, many bodies being brought home. So we need to rebuild our peace movement here in this country. We need to oppose war, because until war is over, and we have perpetual war now, perpetual war in which countries are being wholly devastated. There's nothing there for people to return. Syria has been, you know, flattened. And so what are we going to do if people cannot go home? People want to go home. And we can't absorb the many immigrants, especially the refugees, because we are also in economic crisis. Because in previous waves of immigration, we needed the labor. We needed their labor. We had the resources to provide services for them. But now, our budgets are being cut, devastated, because we have a bloated military budget. We don't have a labor shortage as we did before, because we don't have a manufacturing sector. So we have to end these wars, and we have to rebuild these countries so people can stay in their homes, stay in their countries. And we, in this country, because we are the biggest perpetrators of war, have to rebuild our movement, and women always have to be at the forefront of that movement.
Thank you, Cindy. As you can tell, each one of these people could give, you know, a lecture, series of lectures. I have asked Chandan to do a very difficult job this evening just because he's masterful at kind of synthesizing and seeing the connections between what seem like disparate threads. And so, and he also just makes me smarter when I hear him talk. So I'm gonna turn it over to Chandan and ask you.
No pressure.
Yeah, no pressure. Ask you, you know, your scholarship focuses on the relationship between gender, sexuality, migration, empire, war. In listening to what people have talked about this evening, and the title of this evening is Feminism and War, what reflections do you have about what feminist theory really offers us in this moment of tremendous conflict and violence and war in the world? Yeah.
First of all, I just want to say that it's really a privilege to be on this panel with everyone, and especially to give thanks to Don Mee and Christine for sharing their life's work condensed into very powerful and erudite words tonight. I was thinking about this question that Soya posed, and I think that, you know, I'm going to go very fast, and so though it's not going to be tremendous historical markers, but I'm happy to talk about them during the Q&A. You know, the first thing that comes to mind, of course, is that if we think of feminism as a movement against the domination and the subordination of women, how we understand the origin of women's domination or subordination has mattered a lot to what kind of feminism people have chosen to follow, as well as what kinds of feminisms people have chosen to imagine, and what feminism has understood to be the target of its anti-domination and anti-subordination work. And so, unfortunately, there's no uniform feminism against war. There are varieties of feminisms that have had varieties of positions on Western-led war and Western war. And again, returning to the question of settler colonialism really reminds us of this. The complicities of feminism with settler colonialism, the complicities of feminism with war. So what I thought I would do is just offer a little bit of the different varieties of feminisms that exist, as well as what they have as a relation to the question of war, and what distinguishes them, and how they see this relation to war as also important for understanding how they conceive of where women's subordination emerges. And so the first would be, of course, the feminism that we mostly know, which the person who prevented Cindy from going to Hillary Clinton-style feminism, which we would call liberal feminism. And liberal feminism has a terribly checkered history in relationship to war. It has, for the most part of its history, been complicit with Western colonial wars in its mode of understanding women's domination. So the most classical formulation has been about British feminism in relation to India, where we had the formulation of, you know, white men saving brown women from brown men. And that has been a long-standing position of liberal feminism's participation in the Western war machine in non-Western societies, as well as in the colonized societies of settler colonial states like the US, Brazil, or South Africa. So in that mode of feminism, Western war is distinguished between Western and non-Western. The conduct of Western war is for women's liberation, or can effect women's liberation, because Westernization is seen as anti-subordination. And of course, we've seen the long histories of the effects of those rhetorics and understandings on the production of racist relations between white women and women of color, as well as white women and non-Western women, and the complicities that those have produced. So they oftentimes maintain what we could call core periphery values in the production of their understanding of anti-subordination, that what is anti-subordination in the core will be anti-subordination for the periphery, even though they don't actually understand the relationship between the periphery subordination in the interest of the core societies. The second way in which the liberal feminism has understood war is that it's used the tactic of war for its own interests, most oftentimes during total mobilization efforts. So since World War II, the US has been oftentimes mobilizing its entire populations during periods of acute war for the production of the war machine, and this has meant bringing women into the workplace and into factory labor in particular. And liberal feminism has oftentimes used that particular moment as a way to advocate for anti-discrimination law, as well as for the persistence of women in the workplace, as well as women's participation in contracts and civil society. And so yet, what it hasn't done is made the connections between total mobilization. In other words, what do women who have entered into the workplace like this, or what does it mean to reconceptualize the workplace as gender equality, what responsibility then do we have to the cause of that, which was total mobilization, which was most oftentimes US wars in Asia and Latin America? So that's a question that liberal feminism fails to ask most often. Now, against liberal feminism in the West have been a variety of feminisms that have emerged in decolonizing and in socialist countries. And I'll just sort of separate these very quickly to talk about them in terms of, one, we have what we might call state feminisms. State feminisms are really socialist feminisms, and they themselves need to be kind of differentiated between two different phases of socialism that occur. So to take China as just one example, the state feminisms that were operating before the Tiananmen Square period and the state feminisms that operate now are radically different. The previous one were socialist revolutionary feminisms that were imagining a socialist state. These feminisms were oftentimes coming from the workers' collectives, and they were oftentimes workerized feminisms, and so they actually had very, very specific arguments about a state that could produce modes and structures of conversation and collective leadership and empowerment between state actors and the collectives. And these were much very different forms of feminism. Post Tiananmen Square, what we see is a Chinese state feminism that's more akin to state feminism in Taiwan, or more akin to state feminism in Korea or elsewhere, Hong Kong, where we see that the form of feminism is oftentimes a suppression of more radical expressions of feminism in the region. It's been oftentimes articulated with the development efforts of the state. And this feminism has oftentimes understood the legacy of anti-colonialism as the production of a leadership class. So it becomes a form of feminism that argues that women's anti-subordination operates most effectively when you have a leadership class of women, and that produces significant barriers between women's popular struggles and women who are institutionally located within the leadership units. Now, the other form of feminism that's linked to that is developmental feminism, development feminism, and these would be like the Korean feminisms. And those feminisms, as we know, for example, if you think about the production of the free trade zones, which were oftentimes first begun in Korea and Latin America, and then later moved to Mexico and elsewhere, and have produced some of the migratory patterns that we're talking about. These were oftentimes done in that moment of a development activity. So there was a kind of internal rupture between more radical articulations of feminism that were coming from workers in these new forms of export processing zones that were looking at new modes of capitalist extraction that were making women into workers, but also into hyper-vulnerable workers, and who were excluded from the trade unions because of the processing zone mechanisms, and people who were working with state feminism in collaboration with the trade unionists. And so that has become a big rupture as well. The more radical forms of feminism come from a variety of strands in decolonial movements, and those include oftentimes anarcho and socialist feminisms. These are not Western feminisms. They have Western histories as well. But for example, if you look at Bolivia and Latin America, you see a variety of anarcho and socialist feminisms. These feminisms are fascinating for the ways in which they understand war, which is that they understand war as capitalist war, and they understand women's subordination as connected to capitalist subordination. They also understand war as a system of nationalism that subordinates women. And so these forms of feminism have oftentimes been anti-capitalist as much as they've been anti-war, and they've been critical of the nation form as the model of women's organizing, as the model of women's justice, because they've oftentimes seen the nation as precisely something that can't resolve the question of capitalist war, but can only produce more competition. These also have been feminisms that have oftentimes been, because of their critique of nationalism and culture, experimental forms of living. And so they have been much more small feminisms. Okay, 1 minute. So we're not going to do women of color feminism, tragically. Okay, so I'll just say radical. So let me just say two more forms of feminism that I think are really important on the radical end. One is what we might call radical radical feminisms, and these included lesbian feminisms, and these were very important during the Central American U.S. wars in Central America, because these were feminisms that oftentimes were producing the forms of safe houses that both black women such as Angela Davis and others were using when they were being targeted by the FBI and Control Pro and other programs, but also Central American activists who were being targeted, and as well as what then would become later the first sanctuary movement. So lesbian feminism was really at the core of this, and there was something about the radical disobedience to the rule of law at the bodily level that could produce these kinds of imaginaries that were very central to the form of feminism that got produced as an anti-war feminism. The last one is, of course, diasporic and women of color feminisms. And one thing I will say about these two feminisms is that they've also made critiques of these prior feminisms. And one critique that I think that we have to hold on to, just based on what we're talking about today, is the term that Dawn Mee used in her opening remarks, which is that diasporic feminisms and women of color feminisms, we might say, are predicated on a form of thinking, solidarity, and relationship in which you do not translate yourself for others. It is an attempt to imagine a form of feminism that is not connected to forms of freedom through citizenship or other Western forms of emancipation. It's a form of feminism that then has to think about what is my history and what is your history and where would we find a point of analysis together, and what would be the histories of also complicity in which I might be like the one, the case of the woman from the Japanese Diet, I might have a responsibility to support a feminism that is yours as in a post-imperial subject. So these are different kinds of feminisms, and they've opened up a very different kind of model of thinking the question of radical solidarity. And the last thing I'll say is that one of the things that I think feminism does so well is that these last four feminisms that I've described do so well, is that they make us think that women's subordination and domination shouldn't be framed through national histories, but through histories of war and empire. And they take that as the framework and not as the nation for understanding the questions of women's long histories and uneven histories of emancipation and subordination. Yeah.
Whew. Wow. How many of you were here when we had Chandan on a panel talking about the 1965 Immigration Act, where he broke down like every single US Immigration Act in like 10 minutes? It's kind of stunning. So once my head stops spinning, I want to thank you for that brilliance, because it's not so simple, right? So oftentimes we're taught that, you know, it's really just about, you know, following the leadership of women, any woman, you know, about anything. But really, these are political questions, right? These are deeply political questions about struggle and empire and war and freedom, fundamentally. So at this point, we could go on for hours and hours and hours. I do want to give the panelists like 30 seconds to say one concrete thing that people can do on some of the issues that you're working on, and then I want to open it up for Q&A for the rest of the evening, and then we'll just close out. Is that okay? Let's start with you, Matt, and then just pass it down.
In terms of the fights against the various pipelines, is in the fossil fuel companies' divestment and taking money away from the financial backers of the institutions, but also turning your support towards indigenous communities.
Gosh, just one thing? A number of things. May 1st, Gabriella is heading up a Women of Color and Families marching contingent. Join us to really be out there to show that our communities are not going anywhere, that we're going to stand and together and fight and really lift up this also message that, you know, of international solidarity for immigrants and workers. We have a special guest in town from the Philippines also who will be speaking around the peace talks and really wanting to share like the importance also for the Philippines to resume the peace talks that there have been an active civil war happening in the Philippines. People may not know that, that has been not resumed, and so there is a need to really address those issues. Thank you, Christine, for talking about the peace talks in Korea, because a lot of people don't know that, you know, in order, again, like for people to begin to build livelihood and have access to land, you know, they need to really build that platform of what does it look like to have a government that serves their people.
So one of the organizations I belong to is LILO, and I wanted to, we have a fund that was created in the name of Salmi Domingo and Jean Varenus, and it is at Wells Fargo, and we are going to move that in solidarity with the people of the water. I want to just briefly say that some of us are at the table trying to build a statewide alliance to bring the biggest resist movement, hopefully, in this state to resist this administration's policies, but also to build long-term so that our movement will vie for power to build, to put forth a people's agenda in this state and to join with others around the United States to resist the policies that we're all facing. But we want a long-term movement, not just something that will last 4 years till the next new president, but something long-term. So we hope, if you're interested, the summit is May 13th. We are only asking people by organizations, but if you want to help, because it'll take a lot of people power and money, you know, give me a call and let me know if you're interested.
Thanks, Cindy. I'm going to pass it over to Christine.
Honestly, I don't know with the one thing. So I would say join us. Join Women Cross TMZ. There's a sign-in sheet. There's like collateral out there. I hate to use that language because it's so military. But join us, because there are concrete times when we call for actions. Maybe there could be a Women Cross TMZ organizing group here. I mean, we consider ourselves a global movement of women working for peace on the Korean Peninsula. And if there's one thing you can do tonight is tell somebody, tell your family, tell that the Korean War isn't over and that the U.S. has a responsibility to end the war. Mm-hmm. And as Don Mee pointed, buy her book. Mm-hmm. This is genius, beauty, power, women. So anyway, support Women Cross DMC tonight by buying her book.
Thanks, Christine. So at this point, let's take a few audience questions. I don't know, Vivian, are we okay if we just take maybe 15 minutes? she's like, I'm never going home, I hate you. So yeah, let's just spend 15 minutes and then we'll close out. And thank you for bearing with us. I know that we started late and we're running late. So does anybody have questions for any of the panelists?
Yes.
I think, this is more a comment, and I think part of when we talk about second wave feminism or liberal feminism is this exporting of Western feminism to the rest of the world. And I think, I mean, what we didn't talk about today is, we mentioned Jennifer Laude, but trans feminism. And I think so this is more a comment of like, how do we, you know, deal with the fact that I think, when I think about China, I've talked to feminist organizations in China, and there's this sense of competition of like trans feminist groups and cis feminist, cis women organizations. And I feel very much like that division is a product of US philanthropic organizations pushing out this second wave, you know, very womanist kind of like ideology of feminism. And I just wanted to name that in terms of like, you know, what is that process for us who do work outside of the US, you know, with non-Western feminists? How do we engage with the cultural transphobia that's there, but also not importing like US notions of feminist liberation. So that's just a question.
And I think that's why Beijing was so transforming for me, because coming from the United States, born and raised in the United States, we have our conception of what feminism is. You know, we learn it, you know, sometimes in a college course taught by a white professor, and seeing that the 1960s development of feminism was really a white type of feminism. But I think we define what feminism is and who it encompasses and who builds that movement. I think we always, in this period of time, it's important to see what's going to unify us. And in resisting the attacks against this administration. So we have to build the broadest front around a unity that can unite the majority of people resisting against these policies, because we have so much at stake. They've just got today, we're gonna get a new Supreme Court justice. And that will be damaging for decades on, because it's a lifetime appointment. But in the struggle, while we build this front around the broadest unity, we have to keep struggling in defining, you know, at the center of our movement, and bringing at the center of the movement those that are most disenfranchised, those that are living on the margins. Those are the people that have to be in the forefront, right? And those are the ones that have to define, we have to define feminism, redefine it with our experiences, with our histories, and with who we are building that movement for. So I completely agree with you. I mean, we're an international community in this country, so we can no longer define feminism from a white perspective. Many of our families are here as a result of war and imperialism. And so how do we redefine feminism? And it keeps getting redefined over and over because of who takes up the banner of who defines feminism.
I can say something, but let me make more comments first.
One more question or comment? Did you want to speak to the last question?
Thank you all for meeting today and having such an intellectual conversation. What really struck me early on was when Matt talked about economic terrorism and how really, as each of you shared stories about, you know, feminism and war, we're all related. There's something related about economy, something related about using, you know, women bodies as commodities, and that really was just amazing. And I just wanted to kind of hear about, you know, these protests and resistance and how, you know, especially white feminism, what is centered around that is money is not, you know, something of need for a lot of these, especially, you know, like people like Hillary Clinton and Gloria Steinem. So how do, when you look in your campaigns, how do you see women using money or not using money to make an impact in their own grassroots communities? I really want to hear some realistic stories that you guys have encountered.
Thank you. Some of the examples I've seen are when, for example, there have been a lot of the landless peasants in the Philippines who've been pushed off their land by corporations have to move to the cities and settle there. And so when they're being, again, like forced out by bulldozers, whether that the government wants to use that land for tourism or building malls, or what have you, development. Very similar to what's happening here in Seattle, right? We're seeing communities being displaced. There have been, like the community has built actual barricades and fought off these bulldozers, these policemen. even throwing human feces at them to protect their homes, just, you know, physically protecting their homes. There has been also, in some cases where they're, again, like when they're trying to be forced off their land, and the people who went to Expo shared this story of the farmers who were saying, like, this is my livelihood, this is my life. If I lose my land, I lose my life. And so they are willing to, you know, like, again, like, stand on their land and make sure that, you know, the military, even though they're trying to push them off the land to basically acquire that land for, you know, what have you, monocropping or for research, you know, they're willing to, again, like, hold on to their ancestral lands. And more recently, Gabriella was involved in supporting the Justice for Trafficked Teachers campaign. 300 trafficked teachers from the Philippines ended up here in the U.S. from D.C., and so we were able to highlight that campaign, support a number of the trafficked teachers and getting their T visas, and even to being able to bring back their be reunited with their families. And so the fights look like big scale and small scale, but ultimately it's being there to, you know, like, amplify that there is a liberation movement, that there are people fighting back against corporations and the military.
One of the things with Standing Rock that folks maybe aren't aware of is you literally have, so if you look at the top 10 poorest counties in the U.S., 8 of those counties are all on Lakota, Dakota reservations in North and South Dakota. Our unemployment in Standing Rock is 80%, and our poverty rates are the equivalent of the poorest among the entire Western Hemisphere. Our life expectancy for males is 46 years old, and for females it's 48 years old. You literally have some of the most poorest fighting multinational billion-dollar corporations and federal governments. But one of the things with those demonstrations that you've seen that happened there and with Native communities is none of us are really a part of any groups or organizations or non. I get asked all the time, what group are you with or what nonprofit? I'm like, none. We're not out here to try to make money and to write grants and stuff. We're just doing this because this is what we're supposed to do, because we understand the importance of the land, the importance of the water, the importance of taking care of these places, you know. So when they put that call for people to come to Standing Rock, that's with the understanding that we have a 70-80% unemployment rate. But Lakota, what that translates to is to be a good relative. So you have literally thousands of people coming in from around the world, and we're gonna treat them that way. Even though we have no money, we're gonna find ways to feed and take care of all these people coming in. And that's, I think, one of the things that makes it so, made it so powerful that the rest of the world is seeing that you don't need to be a part of some group or organization and getting grants and funding to do these things. There's and even out here, you know, the people that you've seen opposing or getting Wells Fargo to divest and all that, none of us are part of any groups either. You know, we all have our full-time jobs and families, but we're doing it because we're asked to do it and to contribute. The other thing I wanted to say, though, I realized I forgot the second part of the question you asked at the beginning, and about Earth. In Lakota language, we say maka ina. Maka is our word for the Earth, and ina is our word for mother, and that's what we describe what we're living on, ina maka. So you have these two sisters, Carrie and Mary Dan. They were Western Shoshone, and they were engaged in a long-standing battle against the federal government who was coming in to try to take their lands down in Nevada back in the 70s, 80s, 90s. I mean, they these very fierce Shoshone elders who'd go out there with their rifles to drive off the people from taking their livestock and such. Anyways, I had opportunity to meet them a number of years ago, and we were talking about this kind of subject about violence against women, and I can't remember if it was Mary or Carrie, but they got up and they said, you know, you're not gonna stop violence against women until you stop the violence against the earth. And that's what we got to understand is when there's exploitation of our very first mother, then the exploitation of the life givers follows right after that. So if you look at North Dakota, that fracking started very recently. You know, that was under the Obama administration. He was the one that pushed a lot of that fracking. So that oil boom, that shale boom happened within the past 10 years. As soon as that fracking started happening, you had men from around the world, literally around the world, being brought in to work the oil fields, the fracking up there. The phenomenal increase of violence against women followed, particularly against Native women who were being stolen from reservations and trafficked up into the Bakken region. So you see a direct correlation. Violence against the earth started happening, and violence against the women in that area started happening as well. So the two go hand in hand, and we understand that, you know, we must stop that exploitation of our mother and have a reciprocal relationship, and things will change.
Thank you, Matt. I think we'll end on that note, maybe that notion of feminism, of ending our violence against the earth, violence against women. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight and for sticking around, and I want to ask for just a final big, huge round of applause for Christine Ahn, Don Miche, all of our panelists up here. Thank you so much.